Hey there, welcome to this video series on how to create music with Cubase AI and LE. One of the most important steps in the creative process is setting everything up. And in this second video, we're going to take a look at how you can easily set up an audio interface, a microphone, and a controller so that you can start making music straight away. Setting up equipment can sound tedious, but in reality, it's not that hard. It's a matter of taking all of these external factors like a keyboard or a microphone and a computer, and of course the software, and putting it all together so it's talking to each other. Claire's using a Yamaha Reface, so she's plugging the USB lead into the USB port and of course turning it on and making sure it's connected to the computer. This audio interface is a Steinberg UR22 Mark II, which comes with Cubase AI. If you're using external studio monitors, then it's a great idea to set them up an equal distance from where you're going to be working so that you get a really nice stereo image. Next, it's time to connect the monitors to the output on your audio interface. Once you've done that, turn the monitors on and of course adjust the volume. Also make sure that the audio hardware or interface that you're using is connected to the computer that you're going to use to record. Instruments like electric guitars can be plugged directly into the audio interface without needing a guitar amp, and this particular interface has a high Z input on channel 2, which is great for recording electric guitars, so make sure that's activated if you're recording an electric guitar. If you're working with a microphone, make sure the microphone is plugged into the interface. Now, some microphones require power, and on the back of this interface, we've got this phantom power switch, which sends power directly to the microphone. Then again, it's a matter of making sure that you've got your mic placement right, and if you're recording any other type of instruments acoustically, sometimes it's a matter of, you know, moving the microphones around, recording it, and hearing how it sounds. If you're using headphones, then of course you can plug your headphones directly into the headphone input, which is usually on the front of most interfaces. Now it's time to get the software going. So I'm going to the Studio menu and I'm going down to Studio Setup. Select VST Audio System on the left-hand side here, and now you should be able to see your audio interface in this drop-down menu. If it doesn't appear, then you need to go back and check that you've installed the software for the interface correctly. One of the most terrible things to experience when recording in a DAW is latency. Now, latency is a delay between what you're hearing and what you're actually recording. And you can fix delay issues by going into the control panel. Now, you can see we've got this buffer size here. A lower buffer size will mean less latency. And it'll also mean more strain on the computer. So if you're using lots of inserts and effects and software instruments, then perhaps you might want to consider a higher latency once you've finished recording all the audio and you're in your mixdown stage. We'll deal with that later in another video. Once you're finished, simply hit OK. Next up, we need to make sure we've got the inputs and outputs from the software correctly routed to the inputs and the outputs on our hardware. Now, it's easy for me because I'm only using a Steinberg UR22 Mark II with two inputs and two outputs. So I'm simply going to the input tab and I'm selecting my audio interface. And the only options I have here really are to have one stereo track or two mono tracks. And I can change that in this little drop-down menu here. I'm going to do the same for the output. If you're using a larger interface with more inputs and outputs, then they should all show up here. And it's just a matter of making sure you've got the right inputs and the right outputs selected. Once you've followed these simple steps, you should be able to hear sound coming out of the DAW. So make sure that you've got your audio interface turned up, not too loud to start with, and your studio monitors are turned up, and do something like turn on the click track in the bottom right-hand corner of the software. You can also go over to the media bay and find some sound there. Loops and samples, you'll find some content in there, and it's a matter of clicking on one of the audio files and hitting play. Now, if you can hear sound, great job. You've succeeded in setting up your audio interface. If you can't, then you probably need to go back and just watch the start of this video again and make sure that you've followed everything that I've said. Let's set up a really quick test audio channel now to make sure that our inputs are all working. I'm going to select audio and I'm going to make sure that channel 1 on my audio interface, which is where I've got my microphone plugged in, is selected. And of course, it's a mono track, meaning I'm only recording on one channel. I can also see the routing options on the left-hand side of my inspector. So if I wanted to change over to the right-hand side and record through channel 2 on my interface, I could do that. You should be able to hear sound now, but I can't because I've got the mute button activated on the stereo input track. So notice that sound's going through that stereo input track until I press the record enable button, and then you can see the sound registering on that first channel that I've set up there. And now I can hit record, and you should be able to see a perfect waveform being formed as you record out in the project area. Both Mac and PC operating systems allow you to change the driver or the interface or a MIDI controller for the whole entire system inside the control panel itself. On a Mac, this is called the audio MIDI setup. And if you're struggling to actually access your audio hardware or even a keyboard controller, it's a good idea to open this up and make sure that you can see it registered here. You can also do the same for MIDI controllers. So now I'm going down to the MIDI section, and you can see that I've got the UR22 Mark II listed here. Now, that's got a MIDI interface on the back of it, and that's why an audio device is showing up inside the actual MIDI devices window here. Now, my reface isn't showing up because at the moment I don't have it turned on. But as soon as I turn it on, it instantly appears in this window, and now I know that the operating system is recognizing all of my devices, and I'm ready to use them inside of Cubase. Back inside of Cubase, I should be able to now see MIDI activity down in the bottom right-hand corner when I play notes on my external MIDI controller. So I know that everything's working inside of the software. Once again, if I go to the studio setup, I should be able to see my MIDI controller also listed here. If you can't see it there, then make sure you go to the manufacturer's website and download and install the correct drivers. I know that my MIDI controller is working, but just to be sure, I'm quickly going to load up Groove Agent SE and do a quick test. So once I've got the instrument open, it's a matter of quickly loading a preset and pressing a few notes on my external MIDI controller, and there you have it, I've got sound. So I know that my keyboard is now talking to my instruments. In a similar manner to audio, we could also change different MIDI input and output options, which might be necessary if we're working with a number of different MIDI controllers. So it's worth making the point that you can have more than one MIDI controller connected at any point in time. I'm quickly adding Halion Sonic SE, so I've got two separate instruments up in my track list. Now, whatever track I have selected, or at least record enabled, is the track where the MIDI information is going to be routed in real time. So at the moment, I'm triggering Halion Sonic SE. But if I go back to Groove Agent, then instantly my MIDI controller is controlling Groove Agent. And you can see that red button enabled on whichever track I have selected. A point that could be slightly confusing is that MIDI is transferred inside the software as well. So for instance, the chord pads are a MIDI input and they show up here on the input routing. So if I go down to the Yamaha reface, I'm still triggering the pads because MIDI information is coming from the actual keyboard itself through the pads. If I select something else, like chord pads for example, my reface will still trigger these chord pads up until the point where I move out of the range of the chord pads, and then it stops triggering anything on the tracks. It's always a good idea to leave it on all MIDI inputs so that you can sit down and play any MIDI device that you have connected and it will work. Now you should have everything set up and ready to go, and in the coming videos we're going to look at recording and creating music. Thanks for taking the time to stop by. Please give us a thumbs up and like the video if you've learned something, and of course, subscribe to the Cubase YouTube channel for plenty more videos just like this. I'll see you there.